Short-run costs. Recall the basic cost minimization problem established in Firms and Profits. We had this funny curve called an isoquant, which cut through all the combinations of capital and labor that produced exactly 3 airplanes. What accounts for the shape of the curve? In theory, we could have any sort of curve we care to imagine, but to be realistic, we need to realize some things. 1, workers aren't useful without any tools. And 2, tools aren't useful without any workers. Well, unless those tools are robots. Robots are awesome. In any case, assuming the tools aren't awesome robots, there's a benefit to having a balance between tools and workers. If every worker gets his own toolkit and doesn't have to share, they'll be pretty productive. If he has to share with other workers, some of his time will be wasted waiting for someone else to finish with his wrench. If he has many toolboxes to himself, well, he's happy, but most of those extra tools aren't getting used all that much. So we have this curve. It represents all the points that make it the same exact number of airplanes, say 50. Let's draw some more level sets. This level set might be all the combinations of capital and labor that produce 30 airplanes, and this one produces only 20, and these ones produce 60, 80, and 100 airplanes. Now, what do these lines remind you of? Well, they should look a little bit like the topographic lines on a map, because it's the same exact concept. On a map, there's a line for everything 50 meters above sea level, and 60 meters above sea level, and 70 and 80, etc. Where the lines are close together, you've got a steep slope, and where the lines are far apart, you have a gentle slope. Well, we're going to take a walk on this map. We're going to start with 100 units of capital and no labor, and we're going to see what happens as we add more labor to our fixed stock of capital. We can make a new graph of airplane production per unit of labor as we go. To start, we've got no labor and we produce no airplanes. When we add those first few units of labor, those workers have all the tools to themselves, so we have rapidly climbing productivity. As with a topographical map, when we cross a lot of lines, we're climbing fast. As we add more labor, the workers have to share their tools more, so while airplane production is still climbing, it's not climbing as fast. Eventually, the workers all start to get in each other's way. They have to share tools with many other workers, and production climbs very slowly. So we have this curve, and we're getting what economists call diminishing marginal returns to labor. What it doesn't show us is how much this airplane production costs. Well, no matter what, we have to pay for 100 units of capital. So even when we've got no labor, we have a fixed cost for capital. Also, each laborer is earning the same wage, so as we add labor, our costs go up by 1 hour's wages for each extra hour of labor. The cost of this production is, therefore, a straight line climbing up from this fixed capital cost. If we take our total cost and divide it by the number of airplanes produced, we have a new curve, the short-run average cost curve. Short-run because we're assuming that in the short run, our firm can't change the amount of capital it has. Another curve we can draw from this data is the marginal cost curve. This curve is the cost of each unit of additional production. The marginal cost of the first few units of production are low, because those first few units of labor are very productive. The marginal cost climbs as laborers start to get in each other's way. This curve cuts through the bottom of the short-run average cost curve. Intuitively, if the last unit of production had below average cost, then the average is pulled down. If the last unit of production had above average cost, the average is pulled up. Now that we have some information about this firm's costs, we can start to think about how the firm will behave. That's a topic for my next video.